Okay, in just a minute, we're going to hear from Rabbi David Brofsky from Midreshet Lindenbaum on contemporary conversion challenges in the state of Israel. Here we go. You're on.
Okay, hi, good afternoon, at least in Israel. It's a pleasure to be taking part of this day of Torah learning of Or Torah Stone in honor of Rabbi Riskin and his 80th birthday. Before I begin the topic, which is on the conversion challenges in the state of Israel, or I forgot the exact title, something like that. Maybe a few words about Rabbi Riskin. I've actually had the great honor of sitting with him numerous times on Batei Din L'Giur, on conversion courts, and dealing with a number of conversion cases with him. And Giur is something which is very close to Rabbi Riskin's heart. I'd say in general that Kiruv in general is very close to his heart, and it really goes back to, you know, who he was so many years ago when he started out in America. And I think Giur, conversion, is really part of that outlook of wanting just to bring people closer to the Kadosh Baruch Hu and to Am Yisrael. And there are a number of, you know, I'll mention three things that really stick out from my experiences with Rabbi Riskin. One of them is that, you know, during the times we sat there on the Beit Din, so first of all, Rabbi Riskin takes great interest in each person and in their family and their personality and in their spiritual world and their religious life. And most specifically, he likes to talk about Shabbat, how special Shabbat is and the uniqueness of Shabbat and how it's a day of rest and without phones and. And that's certainly something which always sticks with me. Second, during Kabbalat Mitzvot, you know, at the end of the, you know, if the Beit Din decides to accept the converts, so at the end of the process, the conversion candidate will accept Mitzvot. It's called Kabbalat Mitzvot in front of the Dayanim. They're once again in the mikvah. And the standard formula is, I'll say it in English, is usually where the ger or candidate will say, I accept upon myself the mitzvot of the Torah, the mitzvot of the rabbis and the customs of Am Yisrael and things like that. But Rabbi Riskin would always add in a line where he would ask the person to say, ulitaken olam, meaning that he would ask the person to say, and I accept upon myself to make the world a better place. And it's just obvious to him, meaning I think that's the way he lives, that's what he believes, and therefore it's obvious when a person wants to join the Jewish people that that's something that a person would commit to. I'll just tell one maybe quick story after that. I remember there was one case of a young man that I brought to the Beit Din, and I sat with Rabbi Riskin in the Beit Din, and after the Beit Din decided to accept this young fellow, so Rabbi Riskin pulled out a piece of paper and he wrote his phone number on a piece of paper, and he gave it to the fellow, and he said, please invite yourself for Shabbat, which, you know, is very personal and personable also, and it really takes interest in each and every person. With that said, I want to dedicate the minutes I have left to discussing, again, what I guess the title was, I don't have it in front of me, but, you know, conversion challenges in 21st century Israel. And again, this is something which is very close to Rabbi Riskin's heart and something which he's worked very hard on. Maybe we'll talk about it in a few minutes. But let me begin with a bit of a background. You know, over 3,100 years ago, Ruth HaMoavia, Ruth the Moabite, she left her land and her people and to accompany her Jewish mother-in-law, Naomi, to Eretz Yisrael, with the intention of joining the Jewish people. And the Gemara in Masechet Yevamot understands that this is part of the conversion process. And when she says, Amech Ami velokayach elokai, that you are, she says to Naomi, your people are my people and your God is my God, that that was part of the conversion process of accepting her relationship both to Am Yisrael and to the God of Israel. And Ruth formally joined the Jewish people. And for thousands of years, Batei Din, Jewish religious courts have converted individuals, I guess one could say on an ad hoc basis, primarily because there weren't that many people, I guess, who really wanted to become Jewish. Another reason, you know, was that it was illegal in many areas, meaning the idea that Jews would convert Christians was certainly unheard of. And therefore, conversion, although it was always existing with evidence of conversion and of converts throughout the Middle Ages, and certainly in Chazal we have evidence of that, but there's much greater literature within the past 200 years, the emancipation, and when non-Jews could convert, and there was more intermarriage, which we'll talk about in a second. And we find ourselves now in the year 2020, and we're in a unique situation, really unprecedented. And it's not just a situation, I think one might define it as a crisis. Because we look around the world and, you know, first maybe we'll talk about after World War II. So on the one hand, those Eastern European Jews, certainly those in Russia that survived the Holocaust, after World War II, the Iron Curtain descended and they were trapped in Russia. Behind the Iron Curtain. I remember as a child obviously rallying for them that they should be released, but they were trapped in Russia in a place that had religious persecution. And it was only, you know, when they were, you know, the fall of the Iron Curtain, I guess one could say, meaning when they were allowed to finally leave Russia, that we discovered, first of all, how many Jews there are and how badly so many of them wanted to come to Israel, but how assimilated Russian Jewry had become. And the percentage of intermarriage and assimilation was obviously astonishingly high. And that's also true in the Western world, where Baruch Hashem, there was no Holocaust and no persecution and after the Holocaust I'm talking about, but since the Holocaust in most Western countries, the rate of intermarriage has hovered somewhere between 50 to 70%, which means that a significant percentage of what we would describe as a Jewish community in North America and in Europe and other countries, identify as Jewish and participate in Jewish events. And you'll see them in Hillel and on your campus and things like that. But they're not halachically Jewish, meaning they're not born to a Jewish mother, halachically Jewish mother. And that puts us in a very, as religious or Orthodox Jews, puts us in a very problematic place. And a significant percentage of Jews, of those who associate, you know, identify as Jewish in the diaspora are not halachically Jewish. And I'd like to focus on Israel since Baruch Hashem, the Aliyah from the former Soviet Union, there's been, you know, over 1 million people have moved to the state of Israel. But currently in the year 2020, there are at least 400,000 Israelis who identify as Jewish, but officially have the status of a chasrei dat, which means religionless. And some of them maybe can prove, if they work really hard, to prove that they're Jewish. Some of them, there's nothing to prove that halachically they're not Jewish, but their grandmother was Jewish, and their grandfather, and maybe their father is Jewish, but they're not halachically Jewish. And the question is, what are we supposed to do? And I'll take it a step further, meaning these, you know, Baruch Hashem, again, we're speaking about in Israel, these wonderful people are here to stay in Israel, and they're part of Israeli society, and they will marry here, and they're born here, and they grow up here, and they go to Jewish schools, and some of them even go to religious schools, and they go to the army, and they've accepted, they become part of Israeli culture, and Israeli culture is a very traditional culture, and they're becoming closer and closer to Torah mitzvot, and many of them, some of them observe Shabbat in some way, and kashrus, and they marry into religious families, and therefore the question is, how are we supposed to deal with that issue? Now, there's no like halachic method of what you might call mass conversion. I don't think there's a will. I don't think that the overwhelming majority of these Israelis wish to convert, at least at any given moment. But the question, which I guess, you know, we have to address, and I think urgently, is: are we there? Are we there for them? To offer them the opportunity to convert halachically to Judaism when the time is right. See what I'm saying? Meaning when they are ready to accept upon themselves what we call old Torah mitzvot. Are they there? Are we there for them? And are we making a friendly enough, accessible system of conversion for them? And let me just give another 5 minutes giving a little bit of the history of conversion, especially many related to the cases that, you know, we see nowadays. And then we'll come back to what's going on in the state of Israel. Historically, if you look at the Rambam in Hilchot Isuri Bia, the Rambam describes the classic convert, what he calls the Ger Tzedek. I don't want to say the classic, maybe the ideal convert. This is a person who desires, I'm going to read it in English, to enter into the covenant, to take shelter under the wings of the divine presence. At least so faith, by the way, that Rabbi Riskin would always say and accept upon this person's self the yoke of heaven. And the Gemara tells us that the process of conversion parallels what we're going to read in a couple of days on Shavuot at Matan Torah, the Kabbalah Tamitzvot, and there's a Tvilah and Brit Milah, etc. That's a classic convert who converts because the person found God, Am Yisrael, and they want to join the Jewish people. However, we know, of course, that for many people, the path to conversion does not begin with a dream or with a vision or with discovering God, but it begins often with relationships, most specifically marriage. And the Gemara talks about that. It's not a new phenomenon. The Gemara talks about a person who wishes to convert the Shem Ishut, which means that the original motivation is because they're in a relationship and they want to get married. What's our attitude towards that type of conversion? And it's a debate in the Talmud. According to one opinion, the conversion doesn't hold. It's not a good conversion. However, we rule, meaning the practical halakha, the Gemara is very clear about, it halakha kulam gerim, that it works, meaning that is a valid conversion. Although the Gemara gives the very clear impression that it's not the ideal conversion. It seems also to discourage it. However, we know, and by the way, I should just mention that even in Chazal, you know, the Torah is very clear about it, a very positive attitude towards the ger. The Torah says, Vahavtem et ager, you should love the ger, v'lotonu, one is prohibited from oppressing the ger, the convert. However, in the Talmud, there you have mixed messages. There are statements of the rabbis that, you know, talk about kashim gerim liyisrael kesapachat, that the converts are difficult for the Jewish people, like sapachat, I don't know, like leprosy or something like that. They were suspicious. They were suspicious of outsiders coming into the community and what their impact on the community would be. Despite all of that, we do have evidence during the Middle Ages, whether it be Rabbeinu Tam, whether it be the late Middle Ages and the modern era, post-game like Rav Shlomo Kluger and Rav Chaim Ozer Grudzinski of Vilna, who testify that was the custom, that under certain circumstances, if someone came to the Beit Din, especially if they were already civilly married, again, after the emancipation, I mean, marriage wasn't necessarily in the hands of the local religious community, and people could do whatever they want, and this, you know, couple, the Jew and the non-Jew, they could get married in civil court, they could go to church, they could do whatever they want, but they decide to come to the Jewish community, to the Beit Din, and they want to get married, and they want to convert the non-Jewish spouse. And the post came very open that under certain circumstances that was the practice. Obviously, it depends on the couple and their willingness to commit to living a full Jewish life of mitzvot, etc. I want to briefly present, I guess, what one could say were the three approaches of Jewish communities in the 20th century to this issue of conversion. You know, there are some communities that they completely banned conversion in the 20th century. And the most prominent or famous community that did this was the Halabi community. It's the Syrian community. It started in Argentina, and then it later spread, meaning this enactment was later adopted also in New York by the Syrian community in New York. And again, it first started in 1922, and 1935 was accepted in New York. And every few years, the Syrian community reaccepts this takana, this, you know, sort of communal standard. And the rationale was, meaning the only way to really combat, to fight against intermarriage is to say, there is no chance of conversion. Don't think that if you come with your non-Jewish girlfriend or your non-Jewish boyfriend and you come to us, it's not gonna happen, don't even think about it. And the truth is, on the one hand, it was very effective within the Syrian community. On the other hand, it caused great pain and to many people. First of all, because the New York community, for example, not only would they not convert, they wouldn't accept people who converted elsewhere into their community. And it was simply criticized by a number of great gedolim until even most recently, Rav Asher Weiss criticized his practice. That's one approach to just sort of completely ban and discourage conversion. There was another approach that one could possibly say was very popular within the Sephardic lands. For example, there are a number of testimonies from Egypt, from the book of Nahar Mitzrayim and Yosef Masas and others, and they claim that was the custom in Egypt and other Sephardic countries that, you know, in many Sephardic lands, they didn't have the issues that you had in Ashkenazic lands, you know, where they had this tension with the Reform movement and the, meaning it was basically a very simple choice. Either I could embrace the couple and bring them, you know, into Jewish practice, into the Jewish community, or they could leave the Jewish community and they can live in the Muslim community or whatever other community. And therefore, it was very common in these communities to be very lenient regarding conversion and to convert the spouse and to convert the children, sometimes even convert the children, even if the mother remained not Jewish. And that was a very common practice among Sephardic poskim. Most recently, Rav Uziel, for example, the Sephardic chief rabbi of Israel, the first Sephardic chief rabbi of the state of Israel, was very pro that, open about that approach. He felt that that was the only way to really keep people in and to save what he called the Zer Yisrael, to save the descendants, you know, who would become not Jewish. You want to bring them back into the Jewish people. Rav Adi Yosef also clearly adopted that approach, but we'll talk about that in a few minutes. The third approach is possibly best represented by Rav Moshe Feinstein, which I guess one could say, and this is in many European communities and North American communities, which I guess one could say is very sort of, on the one hand, somewhat ambivalent, even suspicious, but, you know, if you meet the standards, then we're willing to convert you. It's difficult, it's a difficult path, because we want to preserve the integrity of our community and the integrity of your conversion. And conversion isn't necessarily easy, but that's the path of, that's the approach of these communities. Let's bring us a little closer to the state of Israel nowadays. Again, these three approaches, you know, they reflected different communal needs in different areas throughout the world and different Jewish and religious and rabbinic communities. The tradition, again, I said, you know, in the state of Israel, we're grappling with this issue. It's not a new issue in the state of Israel. You know, after 1948, a lot of Jewish refugees came to Israel with their non-Jewish spouses from Europe. Often, actually, they were saved by their non-Jewish spouse. And they weren't killed in the Holocaust because of their non-Jewish spouse, and they came to live in the state of Israel. Later on, you had this phenomenon of the European volunteers on the kibbutzim that often, you know, Sweden, and they came to Israel to volunteer and they wanted to stay and become part of the Jewish people. And in more recent, as I mentioned, you have the Aliyah from the former Soviet Union and those countries, which really has brought a mass of non-Jews. Again, Jewish non-Jews, meaning they live in Israel, they identify as Jews. They're not halachically Jewish, but we're talking about nowadays close to 400,000, if not more. Traditionally, the chief rabbis of the state of Israel were rather lenient and supportive of converting these people. That includes Rav Herzog and Rav Uziel towards the beginning of the state. Later on, Rav Unterman, Rav Nisim, Rav Gorenz founded the Ulpane Gior for the European volunteers I mentioned before. Rav Avadi Yosef is very clear about his leniency towards conversion, Rav Bakshi Daron and others. However, one could say that in recent years, it hasn't really been let's say it differently. The way it currently works now in the state of Israel, there's a conversion path. One can convert in the army do certain limudim, certain programs in the army, and then go to a Beit Din within the army structure. There's a Beit Din that performs conversions. And then in civil life, what they call ezrachi, there's also an option of conversion, attending a shirim and upanim, etc. And many of these conversion judges, and certainly the Olpanei Gior, lovely, I'm saying lovely people who really believe in what they're doing, and they want people to be able to join the Jewish people. However, they're not all like that, or there are too many people who feel like they're not getting the response that they need from the Rabbanut Batidin. They're being turned away, either because of their boyfriends or their girlfriends or their spouses, all different reasons. And definitely the trend in recent years has been among some of the Batei Din in the state of Israel, a trend towards stringency, which, you know, in many ways is sad, because what we need nowadays is actually to find a way to bring all of these, or many of these people, when they're ready, bring them closer and enable conversion. And there is a feeling for many that it's going in the opposite direction. So where does that leave us? It leaves us in a very difficult place that I don't really have an answer to. Meaning, however, I will say the following, that maybe I'll bring this towards back to Rabbi Riskin. Rabbi Riskin was involved in founding a chain of Batei Din LeGiur, of conversion courts, called Giur Kalacha, a number of years ago. The real founder was Rav Nachum Rabinovich Zal. He passed away about a month ago. He was the former Rosh Yeshiva of the Yeshivat Hezder in Mali Dumim. And they and other rabbis felt that they believe that ideally people should convert in the Rabbanut Batei Din, but it's just not happening the way that it should be. And therefore, they decided to take matters into their own hands, I guess one could say. Let me say differently. They felt as rabbis, they have a responsibility to help. That's what rabbis do. We help people. Jim's saying we help them solve their problems when we can. And therefore, they set up this chain of Batei Din. And just two characteristics of the Batei Din. One of them, which was very much encouraged by Rav Nachum Ravinovich, was the conversion of children. The idea being that the Gemara tells us in Masechet Ketubot that Beit Din converts children. Children don't stand in front of the Beit Din and accept upon themselves the performance of mitzvot, because they can't, they're children. I mean, listen, a 12-year-old boy, 11-year-old girl is already mature, but generally speaking, we assume the children don't have that ability. But the Gemara still tells us that the Beit Din has the ability to convert. And a number of including Rav Moshe Feinstein, and it's clear from Rav Chaim Ozer Grudzinski, and this is the path that Rav Nachum Rabinovich took very clearly in a tshuva, and he felt that it's a great zechut, it's a great merit to live in the state of Israel as a Jew. And therefore, even if a person is growing up, a child is growing up in a not fully observant home, in a kosher home, in a home that observes the Chagim and Shabbatot, but maybe not a fully observant home, still one would be able to convert them. In addition, meaning there are a lot of adults, either before marriage or later in life, who are searching for a way to formally become Jewish, halachically become Jewish. And for some reason, the path of the Rabbanut hasn't worked for them. They've had negative experiences or whatever it is. And these Batei Din are performing these conversions. And again, each generation and its own rabbinic leadership are really trusted with the authority to decide what's the best policy for the Jewish people. As Rabbi Yosef Karo in his Beit Yosef says, "Hakol kir'ut hadayan," meaning it's based on the perception of the rabbinic judge, of the dayan, whether or not to accept the convert, to accept the ger. And the thing is, and again, I'll come back to Rabbi Riskin, certainly his strong feeling was that if possible, again, I've seen Rabbi Riskin also, be uncomfortable and not accept certain converts. But the feeling was that, is that when possible, we should bring these people closer and convert them. And it's not an opinion that is his opinion alone. I'll just mention that other great postgame of Usher Weiss, for example, writes that, just quickly read, he says, "In my opinion, our generation is not like previous generations." And he says, "Where in previous generations, we would try to push people away and discourage them from converting." He says, "But in our time period, when so many of those who immigrated from the former Union are not Jews according to the law, and they are mixing in with the residents of the land, there is a great stumbling block for generations, and we should not discourage them from converting. Rather, we should make efforts to convert them and not to discourage them. And I think as we approach Chag HaShavuot, which, you know, in many ways, the core of Shavuot is a non-Jewish woman, Ruth, who moves to Israel and says, Amich Ami Velokayach Elokai, and joins the Jewish people. And the Jewish people accept her as one of their own. And I think that that is something which certainly Rabbi Riskin, certainly that he believed in and stressed and educated towards, and it's something that we should try to internalize as well. I have a few minutes here if anybody wants to ask any questions or clarifications. I'm not really sure how this works, if any. I see, one sec, I see in the chat box, Zera Yehudi. Zera Yehudi, meaning we have a, we do have this notion of what's called Zera Yisrael, the descendants of Jews who technically aren't Jewish. Doesn't mean that it's a free path or a shortcut to halachic conversion. But certainly we, our heart, you know, certainly opened wider for people who come from a Jewish parent or Jewish grandparents, and they live in Israel, to somehow bring them back in and enable them, if possible, to have a halachic conversion. Any other questions or comments? Okay. It was a pleasure. It was a pleasure being with everyone here. Okay, maybe we'll wait one more second to see if anyone has any last minute comments or questions before the next speaker pops up. Oh, I see Rabbanit Sally has joined us. She'll be giving our next year.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, David, for your very thought-provoking shiur.
Okay, it was good to be here.
We have a couple minutes before the next slot. We want to start at the right slot in case people are waiting to sign on. So if you have any other thoughts that you want to share in the meantime, otherwise we'll just wait a couple minutes before the next year.
I think I'll sign off.
Okay.
Okay, very good. Sally, batzlacha.
And you. Take care. Thanks, Amir. Bye.